Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ovid, A Very Short Introduction by Llewelyn Morgan, narrated by Michael Page. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to figures included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Chapter 1. Introduction. P. Ovidius Naso. Vivam. So ends Ovid's masterpiece, the 15-book Metamorphoses. I shall live on. The meandering timeline of this hugely influential poem has at long last reached the present day, and the poet celebrates the rise to power of the Caesars, Julius Caesar and his adoptive son and heir, Augustus. But it is with Ovid's own achievement that the poem concludes, 15, 871-879. Now I have brought to completion a work that neither Jove's wrath, nor fire, nor sword, nor devouring age will have the power to efface. When it wishes, let that day which has jurisdiction over nothing but this body put an end to the span of my uncertain years. Still, in the better part of me, I shall pass immortal beyond the lofty stars, and my name will be imperishable. And as far as Roman might extends over the conquered world, I shall be spoken on the lips of the people, and through all ages in high repute. If the prophecies of bards contain any truth, I shall live on. Given that we are still reading the Metamorphoses 2 millennia after Ovid's death, this can count as a remarkably accurate prophecy. What is more, no Greek or Roman poet is as accessible today as Ovid to artists, writers, or the general reader, or has ever been in the intervening years. For if Ovid can seem at times to us in the 21st century a compellingly modern and contemporary voice, so he did in the 16th, 12th, and back in the 1st. Which is not to suggest that Ovid's poetry is easy. A mistake first-time readers often make is to assume that his comparatively straightforward Latin reflects straightforward poetic thought. In fact, Ovid is the most sophisticated and self-aware artist in a tradition of Latin verse, indebted in turn to Greek poetry, that foregrounds those qualities. Nor can it be claimed that Ovid's poetry has met with an exclusively uncritical press. In poetry and in life, Ovid courted controversy, which both brought him celebrity and contributed to the banishment from Rome that he suffered at the height of his popularity. Some believe that the epilogue to the Metamorphoses was written in exile, and the idea that his better part consisted in the verse that would survive him certainly resonates with the anguished ruminations of the aging exiled poet on poetry that had contributed to his misfortune but remained his greatest consolation. Enthusiastic acceptance and equally vehement rejection have been the story of his reception, too. The sweet, witty soul of Ovid that Francis Mears in Palladis Tamia, Wit's Treasury, 1598, identified in mellifluous and honey-tongued Shakespeare is one side of this afterlife. John Dryden's distaste for Narcissus' soliloquy in Metamorphoses 3 in Fables Ancient and Modern, 1700, its self-indulgent boyisms so inferior to Chaucer, is another equally representative. The Drydens have their place in this story, even as we emphasize the sweetness and wit. Where Mears and Dryden might agree is that Ovid was a man and a poet constitutionally incapable of resisting a good joke. Publius Ovidius Naso, Naso indicates an ancestor with a prominent nose, was born on the second day of the Quinquatrus, a festival of the goddess Minerva, in the consulship of Gaius Pansa and Aulus Hirtius, in more familiar terms, 20 March 43 BCE. The Ovidii were domi nobiles, local elite, an ancient family, as Ovid asserts and surviving inscriptions confirm, from Sulmo, a town set in a fertile intermontane basin in the Apennine Mountains east of Rome. Sulmona, as it is known today, was one of the leading towns of the Paeligni, a people of central Italy who in the days of Ovid's grandparents had gone to war against Rome, driven to honorable arms by their love of freedom, Amores 3:15-9. This war between Rome and its erstwhile Italian allies, the Social War, 91 to 88 BCE, was a catalyst, paradoxically, for accelerated unification of the peoples of the Italian peninsula, a process which Augustus, the first emperor of Rome, was eager to take the credit for fostering and completing. By Ovid's time, a native of Italy was also by definition a Roman citizen, and powerful Italian families like Ovid's had been absorbed into the Roman ruling classes. Had he followed a conventional Roman script, Ovid himself could have represented a culmination of this development, the first Paelignian member of the Roman Senate. This was certainly the ambition of Ovid's father. Alongside his brother, exactly a year his senior, Ovid was groomed for a public career, studying rhetoric in Rome and in Athens, a city past its glory days but still a center for education. But while his brother showed a bent for oratory and the law, Ovid's was always for poetry. Obedient to his father and further motivated by his brother's premature death when Ovid was 19, he dutifully took the first steps on a political career, holding two minor magistracies, the second of which was certainly of a judicial character and opened the way toward the Senate. He also acted as an arbitrator of private suits, a role that might indicate a reputation for competence. In the Remedia Amoris, Cures for Love, he seems to offer a glimpse of his legal career when he recalls representing a husband in divorce proceedings, which the husband abruptly drops when he sets eyes upon his wife again, 661 to 670. But it was no good. The muses would not let go. I was affected by my father's words, and leaving Helicon wholly behind me, I attempted to write words freed from metre. But of its own volition, song found its fitting rhythm, and whatever I tried to say was verse. Tristia 4:10-23-26. That account comes from an autobiographical poem that Ovid wrote late in life. The Senate House awaited me, but I reduced the width of my stripe, he continues. He replaced a tunic bearing a broad purple stripe, indicating senatorial ambitions, with the narrow parallel stripes of the lesser equestrian social order. As early as his late teens, Ovid had begun to make a name for himself as a poet, and his autobiography moves on from his abortive public career to the literary scene of his youth. Propertius was the author of love poetry that Ovid would imitate in his first collection, The Amores, and Q. Horatius Flaccus, or Horace, was the composer of one of the most celebrated achievements of Roman literature, the lyric poems known as the Odes. Both seem to have been close acquaintances of the precocious Naso. But Virgil I only saw, Virgilium vidi tantum, the greatest poet in a remarkable flowering of literature under Augustus, Virgil was the author of the epic Aeneid, a celebration of Rome's and Augustus' right to rule. The most significant cultural achievement of the Augustan age, the Aeneid also reset Roman literature. No poet thereafter could ignore it, as Ovid's wistful reminiscence implies. Virgil was 30 years older than Ovid, shy and reclusive. He died in 19 BCE. Tibullus, another love poet, died in the same year, too early, Ovid says, for them to be friends. Amores 3:9 is Ovid's poem-long lament for him. All these poets are conventionally described by scholars as Augustan poets. In truth, though, much of Virgil's and Horace's poetry was written before Augustus ended years of conflict and secured control of Rome by defeating Mark Antony and Cleopatra in 31-30 BCE. Their masterpieces, the Aeneid and the Odes, were written early in Augustus' reign, and both works are still intensely exercised by what had gone before, the civil wars that the historian Tacitus called unbroken strife for 20 years, no custom, no law, Annals 3:28. Ovid's life, in contrast, had begun in upheaval, both the consuls in his birth year, Hirtius and Pansa, dying during their tenure, casualties of the violence that had followed Julius Caesar's assassination in 44 BCE. But the mature Ovid, coming of age in the early 20s BCE, never experienced the crisis to which Augustus and everything he entailed, restrictions on freedom, greater surveillance of private lives, were, for writers such as Horace and Virgil, a necessary response. Ovid's poetic career began shortly after Augustus assumed that honorific name in 27 BCE. He had previously gone by the name of his adoptive father, C. Julius Caesar, and he died 3 or 4 years after the emperor. In that sense, and in the pleasure and inspiration he drew from the thriving, peaceful city over which Augustus presided, Ovid is the most Augustan of the Augustan poets. But this most Augustan poet, who had never really known anything but the Pax Augusta, also had the least emotional investment in Augustus' achievement, and it shows. Ovid's poetic career is clear enough, in outline at least. The order of composition generally assumed is amores, loves, single heroides, heroines, ars amatoria, art of love, remedia amoris, cures for love, metamorphoses, transformations, fasti, calendar, tristia, sad poems, ibis, the bird, epistolae exponto, 1-4, letters from the Black Sea, and double heroides. Poems were rewritten or written simultaneously to disrupt this tidy consecutive list, of course, and Ovid also wrote poetry which now only survives in fragments. The Phenomena, probably Juvenilia, was a translation of a poem on constellations by the unaccountably popular Hellenistic poet Aratus, 3rd century BCE, something on which young Roman poets were in the habit of cutting their teeth. Medea, a tragic drama, fell between a second edition of the Amoris and the Ars Amatoria, and proved, so the later critic Quintilian, circa 35 to circa 100 CE, reckoned, what heights Ovid could have attained if he had been willing to direct his talent, not indulge it. Quintilian Institutio Oratoria, 10-198. But Quintilian, it is fair to say, had no sense of humour. The cosmetics for the female face, medicamina faciae femininae, was apparently a dry run for the Ars Amatoria, its failure to survive in full no doubt a result of the success of the latter poem. And there were short epigrams. Another possibility emerged from an archaeological dig in the vicinity of Sulmona. Excavations of the sanctuary of Hercules Curinus on the slopes of Monte Morone, traditionally identified as Ovid's villa, were begun in 1957, the bimillennium of Ovid's birth. One intriguing discovery was a pillar bearing ancient graffiti, including 12 lines of poetry with Nasonis by Ovid inscribed above them. The verses, only partly legible, do not correspond to any of his surviving works. These lines may or may not be by Ovid, but there are certainly other cases where the mystique of Ovid's name has attracted poems to it that we don't believe he wrote. An example will show how freely attributions floated about in antiquity and illustrate the fundamental paucity of information that modern scholars have to contend with. A fragment of the Haliutica, a poem on sea fishing, would not be associated with Ovid at all if it weren't for Pliny the Elder, who cites the poem and attributes it to Ovid in his Encyclopedic Natural History. Pliny was writing only 60 years or so after Ovid's death, but it is surprising how quickly accurate knowledge of poets, as opposed to their poetry, could be lost. Similarly unlikely things are being attributed to Virgil shortly after. Information persists in Greco-Roman antiquity if it is written down, essentially, and that is more likely to happen to great poetry than the mundane details of a poet's life. Thus, while Ovid's poetry largely survives, basic biographical information is lost to us, and we owe what we do know about Ovid largely to his own reminiscences. Suetonius, a century later, effectively invented the genre of biography and wrote lives of poets, among others, but we don't know whether he ever wrote a life of Ovid, and if he did, it doesn't survive. A factor specific to Ovid, however, is his circumstances at the end of his life, which is when Pliny believed he wrote the Haleutica, 32-152. Whatever Augustus' intention in banishing Ovid, it had the effect, in a culture enjoying only very rudimentary communication technology, of making the poet disappear from sight. Ovid's own poetry from exile was in large part an effort to counteract his invisibility in Rome, but it remains the case that remarkably little information survives in ancient sources about the final years of a man who had been the most feted writer in Rome. Between Ovid's death in 17 or 18 CE and a notice of his death in St. Jerome's Chronicon, 381 CE, a chronology of events from Adam to his own day, we have just one isolated reference to Ovid's exile in a poem by Statius at the end of the 1st century CE, and even here the allusion is rarely to the poetry that Ovid had sent back to Rome. Jerome's notice against the year 17 nevertheless reminds us of one of the most important facts about this author, though we're not entirely confident even here of the precise date. The poet Ovid died in exile and is buried near the town of Tomis. Aside from Ovid's death date, 17 or maybe 18, we have just a skeletal framework of absolute dates to set his career within. Birth in 43 BCE, his brother's death in 24 BCE, references in the Ars Amatoria and Remedia Amoris to events that place those poems securely between 1 BCE and 2 CE, and his exile in 8 or 9 CE. Hard to date precisely, it may be, but Ovid's poetry makes good sense as an oeuvre. One thing that binds his rich and diverse body of work together is a restless commitment to innovation. Exhausting the possibilities of love elegy, Amores, he wrote a lover's guide, Ars Amatoria, a brilliant reinvention of love elegy in a new guise, and then capped that with a guide to falling out of love, Remedia Amoris. Letters from abandoned mythical heroines, the single Heroides, were followed, sometime later, by exchanges of letters between mythical lovers. Above all, in the Metamorphoses, love poetry was not so much abandoned as reimagined as epic plot. Ovid was famous, indeed notorious, for his ingenium, his inspiration or native wit. But these innovations also tell us how popular his poetry was, how successful he was in finding a readership that demanded ever more from him. By the time of the Ars Amatoria, furthermore, Virgil, Propertius, and Horace were all dead, and Ovid had the stage effectively to himself, the dominant cultural voice of his day, with one fatal exception, Augustus. The emperor had his narrative of national renewal driven by moral discipline and respect for the past, and it was a potent one. As for Ovid, a disapproving contemporary complained how he filled this age with amatory arts and ideas. L. Cestius Pius, quoted by Seneca the Elder, Controversiae 3:7. The story that Ovid told had its own seductive power, but it was a persistent, albeit subtle, variance with Augustus, and this was an irritant for which the emperor's patience would not prove to be limitless. My term innovation here needs some clarification. Ovid was a radical spirit within a deeply conservative literary culture. Each of Ovid's new departures is actually a twist on established convention. For example, his Amores plays inventively with the rules of a genre or subgenre, love elegy, established and refined by predecessors such as Propertius and Cornelius Gallus, while the Metamorphoses is an exuberantly unorthodox epic which only works as such if the pre-existing rules of the form are understood. This poetry is intensely aware of its predecessors as objects of both respect and rivalry, and reminiscences of earlier poetry, referred to as allusion, are not only common but essential means of expression. This style of poetry has been neatly encapsulated as creative imitation. Its imitative character diminishes the power of this poetry not a whit, I should insist. Indeed, I would propose that there can only be true originality in the presence of established rules, and the traditional character of Greco-Roman literature merely acknowledges that truth. A name that will feature regularly in this book is Callimachus, a Greek poet active in Alexandria, the capital of Greek Egypt, in the 3rd century BCE, and associated with the famous Library of Alexandria, within the original museum, a kind of ancient research center, who exerted a huge influence over Roman poetry from its earliest days. His most celebrated poem, the Aetia, Causes, only survives for us in fragments, most of them on papyri discovered in Egypt at the turn of the 19th and 20th centuries. In a series of narratives, the Aetia had explained the origins of peculiar rituals, practices, and artifacts across the Greek world and beyond. The first Roman to appear in Greek literature featured in one of Callimachus' stories. In Ovid's oeuvre, the Fasti, his poetic calendar, bears a particularly close resemblance to the Aetia, as we shall see. But in this poem and elsewhere, Callimachus had expressed strong opinions on poetry in memorable ways, and his imagery of pure fountains, slender muses, and untrodden roads was much exploited in Roman poetic manifestos. Whether those Roman poets understood Callimachus' pronouncements exactly as he had intended them is less certain, but he came to represent for them a cluster of literary principles which had formative importance in the literature of this period. Those principles include an emphasis on writing over performance, an intellectual and self-aware approach to composition which reflected Callimachus' real-life role as an academic at the museum, literally Temple of the Muses, familiar with the long history of Greek literature, a preference for brevity over length, indistinguishable from a rejection of higher forms of poetry, epic especially, in favor of humbler genres and subject matter, and a promotion of an individual perspective, a first-person narrator over the omniscient, impersonal narrative conventional in more elevated genres. The essential affinity between Callimachian and Roman poetics lay perhaps in a shared belatedness. Callimachus, a Greek poet sensitive to his late appearance in a glorious tradition of literary achievement, while Roman poets bore the burden of both their own native literature and the Greek literature before it, a daunting challenge to their own creative abilities. Callimachian poetry, sometimes also called Hellenistic, a word evoking the vastly expanded Greek world after the conquests of Alexander the Great and its wealthy urban centers, was inherently elitist poetry. A well-read poet wrote for comparably sophisticated readers, and thereby reduced his natural readership to a very restricted slice of ancient society. Publishing books in Rome was a matter of making one's work available to be copied. There were commercial booksellers, but much of this copying will have been done privately, with circulation primarily among Ovid's acquaintances within literary society. Poets also shared some of their poetry in recitations, another select gathering to which the great and good might be invited. And a new phenomenon at Rome in Ovid's day was public libraries, from which he tells us that his poetry from exile was excluded. Another source informs us with some poignancy that Ovid was a close friend of the man in charge of the great library established by Augustus on the Palatine Hill, see Julius Hyginus, Suetonius Grammaticus 20. There is some evidence that Ovid's poetry penetrated deeper into Roman society than most poetry did. Ovid himself refers to performances of probably his Heroides on stage, featuring an element of dancing, and these would have widened his audience significantly. But it remains the case that the target audience of this poetry is narrow, and the literature itself evidence of how the Roman upper classes policed access to their charmed circle. The cultural capital required to play the literary games that this poetry typically involves, the knowledge of Greek language and literature, art and philosophy that it demands, is immense. At the same time, what its socio-economic origins ensure is poetry of unparalleled sophistication. 2,000 years old it may be, but we can banish from our minds any thought that it might be primitive. A final respect in which Callimachus was an important model for Ovid is metrical. poetry is simply not poetry in this literary culture unless it observes a set metrical system. In Greco-Roman antiquity, essentially a matter of the number and length, long or short, of syllables. When Ovid describes how he tried to do legal prose, but it always came out as verse, prose is words freed from meters, and classical meter can, to the uninitiated, seem an arbitrary straitjacket for poetry to adopt. But as with the generic conventions we have already glimpsed, a poet like Ovid can achieve meaning by manipulating established metrical practice, and can do so partly because in Greco-Roman antiquity, genre and meter were closely associated. The two metrical systems relevant to Ovid are the so-called dactylic hexameter, which was the vehicle for epics such as Homer's Iliad and Virgil's Aeneid, and consequently known as the heroic meter by the ancients, and the elegiac couplet, the meter of all Ovid's surviving poems, bar the Metamorphoses.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.